Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT. Bandwidth for Triangulation is brought to you by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com. This is Triangulation, episode 112, recorded July 24th, 2013. Me! Triangulation is brought to you by Bespoke Post, a product subscription club for men. Bespoke's monthly box of awesome keeps you up on the latest in food, drink, fashion, and more. For 20% off your first box, go to bespokepost.com/twit. It's time for Triangulation, the show where we get interesting people. I usually say smart, but not in this case, on the show, and we get to interview them, ask them what's going on, and this is a little bit of a turnabout triangulation because today is the second anniversary, July 24th, 2013, 2 years after we moved into the Brick House studios. We thought we'd do something a little bit different, something people have been asking for. I'm not sure why, but people have said, why don't you be a guest of Triangulation? You have somebody interview you. So that's what we're going to do. And I can't think of two better people to interview me than my two oldest friends here, people I worked with at Tech TV, first met more than 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Sarah Lane and Tom Merritt. So thank you, first of all,
for
coming all the
Tom,
way.
Oh my gosh.
Oh my God, from TNT.
Where did you come
from?
The answer may surprise you.
Tom flew all the way
up
just for this, so we thank you for doing that.
It was really fun.
And boy, are his arms tired.
And Sarah got out of bed, which is rare, and came in on a Wednesday. So
I didn't brush my hair. Let's not go crazy.
No, you look great.
Gotta stay authentic.
So, yeah, you do this all the time. I'm going to start with this question. When did you start being so damn humble about, I usually say smart person, but not in this case?
Well, I like being self-deprecating. What are you going to say? You don't want to say...
Were you always like that?
No, actually, I'm not humble.
I was going to say, Tom, what are you talking about?
but I do that because, I don't know, I think it's kind of...
It's better than the other way.
It's better than the
I'm
other...
I'm so
you
great.
Know, when I first heard Rush Limbaugh on the radio, it was kind of a revelation because Rush was one of the first people to say, you know, with gifts on loan from God, he actually intentionally and quite successfully flipped
Lean
that.
Lean into that.
Yeah. But I've always thought self-deprecating humor was the best kind of humor. You don't want to go too far. You don't want to say, I'm such a loser. But I think it's better to self-deprecate. And the truth is, I wouldn't want to say, here's one of the smartest, most interesting people on the internet. So
Me.
Yeah, hi. Tom Merritt.
But you are a smart guy. That's my point in asking.
You are a smart person. I mean, look at all of this.
I didn't bring you here to say nice
worry.
Things about me.
We're just setting up.
I'm getting embarrassed. Thank you.
You know, I had said to Tom beforehand, 2 years ago seems like a whole nother world ago.
This still feels like my new studio, doesn't it?
Yeah,
it's still the new studio.
It does, but at the same time, I wore the shirt because I wore this exact same shirt the first day that we had our first
TWiT. And quite a few times since,
Sunday.
I might add.
Yes, yes.
With washing.
It actually does have some olive oil stains, neither here nor there. But
well,
I was like,
neat.
I was trying to get into the spirit of everything, and I thought, gosh, I
hair
really
was about the same length.
Yeah.
We checked.
I have in the back
it's
all my screensavers
time,
wardrobe. I mean, those shirts, and I frequently wear them, are, you know, the same shirts that I wore in the screensavers and Call for Help as long as, 15 years ago now, right?
Do you do that on purpose? Because I've noticed that, where you just grab a shirt. It'll be some kind of logo shirt, maybe a Tech TV logo shirt. Do you do that so you don't have to think about it?
No, sometimes I think about it. Like Kevin Rose was on TWiT on Sunday, and I wore a Tech TV shirt that day because I thought it'd be fun to wear.
Picked it on purpose.
Yeah. Sometimes I mean, I'll spend a lot of time.
Jobs thing where you're trying to.
Do I look like somebody spends a lot of time thinking about what he's wearing?
Believe me, I don't even.
I was saying this before the show began. You have the very inspired, very smart thing, putting a jacket over your shirt. All men should always wear jackets.
Yeah,
I think.
And then I didn't wear it today, but yes, no, that's.
I like that. You look dapper. You look sharp.
It looks good. And
you could wear a T-shirt. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, exactly. Sometimes I do. Well, you know,
when did we first meet, Tom?
We first met in August of 1999.
Wow, that long ago.
Yeah, when I came up.
Almost exactly 14 years ago.
I flew out to San Francisco to do interviews at a bunch of different places. One of them was ZDTV. And they said, Tom, you're going to be interviewing with David Miller, the vice president of Web.
I'm like,
okay.
Him.
And of course, me, Regina Preciado, she was the person hiring me.
Regina,
Leo Laporte, he's the host and managing editor of the show. And we gave you a copy of the show so you know who he is. And,
oh, so this
and
was
he needs to sign off on this, too.
This was to work on the screensavers.
To work on the screensavers on the web. And I knew that David Miller was the big person that would make the decision. And Regina already indicated that she kind of liked me, and she would have a lot. But I was most worried about talking to you.
Yeah, who is
I
this guy?
I went out and I bought, because I'd seen the show, I bought a copy of PC Magazine, a copy of Wired. This is how old it was. There were only I went to the Internet Cafe to do some research, too. And I studied up, and I've told this story before, but I sat down to meet you in your cube. And you said, what was your first computer? And I said, TI-99-4A. And you said, you're hired.
That was mostly because I just didn't want to waste
time. You're like, great, I need to go over to
I can have a beer now. Where was it we used to go? The Greasy Fries.
Mars.
Mars Bar.
Yeah.
Still does.
It's still there?
Doesn't look
it's
any
still
different.
Cooking.
Yeah, still has that crappy little backyard.
That place was a dump. Now, I remember when we were thinking, you were probably around when we were thinking of hiring Sarah. She worked at Channel 4, KRON.
I did. And I kind of knew you because we both worked on New Media News.
We followed each other. Yeah.
Yes.
You followed me.
Yeah. You were there before. Well, I was still in college.
With Suzanne Shaw.
With Suzanne Shaw and
Stan I don't think you were born yet, actually.
Hush you.
You were at least in high school.
No, I was an intern when you were on the show because I was working up in the
Yeah, we were in San Jose. We did it out of San Jose.
The San Jose Bureau, yeah. Which I moved to right after you started at Tech TV, which was interesting because I went to San Francisco State, studied broadcasting, and a lot of the people that I graduated with, that graduating class was some of the first hires at ZDTV.
Yeah.
Because ZDTV started when we were all graduating. Roger it was like Chang a lot of people's first jobs. Right?
Roger Chang,
among many others.
You went to school with Roger. How
I
funny.
I did. Yeah, and the broadcasting school was, you know, it was somewhat tight-knit. A lot of us knew each other.
It's actually very famous, very good, and I think still is, television and film
it is, yes.
program.
Now, we're witnessing one of the brilliances of you, Leo, which is your ability to turn the interview back around. To get us talking about ourselves.
Damn it, he knows.
And we talked about this.
But wait a minute, I'm not finished. So, because I just wanted to finish this one anecdote.
All right.
Because I remember, I don't know, was it Paul Block there yet? No.
Yes.
He was.
Well, he had just been hired, and Peter Hammersley hired me, and then Paul Block wanted to, like, hire me himself.
He was the executive producer of the Screensavers.
He was new and didn't like the idea of this.
Because I remember, well, you were very expensive. This was the deal was... she is very, we're getting something very expensive. Is she worth the money?
You didn't remember it that way, huh?
It was not a lot of money in hindsight.
It was expensive for Tech TV.
It was like...
Yeah.
Should
I not say?
Yeah. No, we're not going to talk about my salary.
It was $42,000 or something like that?
That's not right, but it doesn't matter.
But I remember it was more than we were paying anybody else at that same level.
Yeah.
And people were saying, well, should, you know, is she worth it? She's awfully young. I think we bit the bullet. We said no, we should really hire her because she's got good chops. And New Media News is one of the few. There weren't that many technology shows.
No, so it was a news magazine show about technology, which is like besides Tech TV, who's doing that?
But that's what I remember was the fear was that you were a little expensive for the budget.
Yeah.
But then you were the web.
Though, because from the very beginning, I learned quickly that you don't really like to communicate and like put together a well-crafted segment ahead of time. You just like to do things on the fly because that's the person.
There's
that
another
you
are. Way to put it. I don't like to rehearse.
Okay, fine.
Free speech.
But I wasn't as bad as Patrick.
No, I'm not saying that you don't like to talk, communicate. You basically wanted to say, I trust you.
I did trust you.
Give me my blue card, everything will be fine.
Let my producer do it.
And
give me my blue card.
That is why
Where's
I
the camera?
Like
Where's my mark?
Where are my bullet points?
Because I was like,
Where's faster my prompter? Like,
I don't really
don't tell me
talk
to rap, Russ Pitts.
So it worked out.
Okay, I'm going to give you guys complete...
To this day, our relationship is exactly the same.
It hasn't changed. I do the same thing. Yeah. You do all the work, and I just show up and say, where are my blue cards?
And it's fine. So it works out fine.
One of the things, and we talked about this earlier today, you talk about, you're honest, you're open about your life. So it's not like people are...
Yeah, I don't know what you're going to interview me about, because
I've already
said everything.
I've already said that. Yeah. But one thing I don't think you talk as much about is growing up. What kind of kid were you?
My kids say I was a nerd because you've seen pictures of me and I look pretty nerdy with my Mao cap and my overalls and my necktie.
I had some good hair.
And great hair. I had lots of
it. You still have good hair.
I do. And, you know, truthfully, I'll be honest with you. I think success in television relies on two things. Good hair. If you have good hair, you can't be like there's not a lot of bald people who have made it in TV. Right, Tom?
Dr. Phil. That's all I can think of.
Dr. Phil.
Yeah. Jim Cramer, maybe?
I don't know. No, he's not. I wouldn't say he's a...
Ball?
He's not a model.
He's not successful.
So you have to have good hair, and I think I have a good voice, and I think that that's really the only secret to my success. Right there. That's it.
Well, it is the voice. The radio voice is actually you know, that you either have it or you don't.
It's soothing.
It is.
And it helps people sleep.
And but did you always have that voice, or is it something you cultivate?
No, I didn't. Although every once in a while I hear my voice and I hear tones of my father's voice in it. So I think I do probably sound like my dad a little bit, but more resonant. So I did. I mean, you work in radio, you work on the resonance. You worked in radio. You work on the resonance of your voice, and you're always listening to your voice. So I think it got more resonant because I worked it more.
And when did you start thinking about
it? I started doing voices and stuff like that when I was about 3, literally.
Like doing imitations?
Talking into a coffee can so I could hear what I sounded like. I had I was probably about 11, we got a very early cassette recorder. And I started doing commercials and stuff into the cassette recorder. So I'm really doing what I always thought
realistic,
I would do.
Like tan ones.
It was such a funky thing because it had wood. It had a wood. It was probably designed for a home stereo system, a component, and a big chunky buttons. And we had it hooked up to the stereo. And I remember once I was doing this recording and stuff, played it into my parents' bedroom. They had a stereo speakers in there. And they, after like, I wish they'd said something right away, but it was like an hour later they came out and said, well, that was funny. I said, you heard all of that?
Oh, no.
It was so embarrassing, but I was making up commercials and...
Sounds familiar.
I think, I still make up commercials. By the way, have you seen their...
Do you have any of those tapes? Have you digitized any of that stuff?
No, I don't have... In fact, one of the things that makes me sad, Dvorak has some tapes of our early radio show, but I don't have early tapes at all. You know, you make a lot of air checks, but they're on reel-to-reel and cassette, and then they were in boxes.
Forget kid,
when I was on the radio. I don't have stuff from... I don't even have... any more tech TV stuff.
So was it always talk radio stuff? Were you imitating?
No, because, well, in radio, I wanted to be an actor.
Okay.
But when I started in radio, I had to be a DJ playing music. You did that too, right?
Yeah.
KMOX, St. Louis. And so that was you, not me.
No, I wasn't at KMOX.
What were you on?
WGEL. Other
if I'd known that, I don't know if we would have hired you in the first place. You know. I thought it was KMOX. No, you start in college radio playing music, and you're stupid in college. You think, oh, this is fun. I'll get to play the music I really like and talk. And then you get in a real world, and they give you a piece of paper, say, this is what you're going to play today. And it's the same 20 songs over and over and over again. And so it really wasn't very satisfying.
Wait, so you're telling me that when they say if you're the 20th caller, we'll play your song?
No,
it's just
that's
a
lie. We take requests and all that stuff. You know, you're doing during commercials.
You take a request that is already on the piece of paper.
Right, it has to be on that piece of paper. It's not the good news is most people are asking for the same 20 songs over and over again. Yeah. So you're recording it reel to reel in the background, and you take all the calls, and then you pick the one you're going to play. And then you play it. We come out of the commercial, you press play. And it's, hey, it's KMOX. What do you want to hear?
I'd like to hear my favorite, Kenny Rogers the Gambler.
Hey, there it is. And by meanwhile, you started it exactly so you know that the speaking will end right when the song, hey, you have to
hit
know
the post.
Where to hold them. So it's all a perfect medley of wonderfulness.
So you got into it in college? Was that
college? So
where did you go to college?
I went to Yale, and when I was, I think my sophomore year, I always did a lot of voices. And even when I first started in college, I was still doing a lot of voices, silly voices, comedic stuff. I listened to Firesign Theater. I was doing
a
lot of
that.
That was a big inspiration.
Theater, yeah.
And so I was doing a lot of those voices, and then. I was working in the dining hall serving food.
I worked in the dining hall, too.
Berklee College dining hall serving food. And, you know, they're coming in the line. And you go, and, but I would always say, hey, here's some fine mashed potatoes for you. Would you like a pat of butter? And
really?
Doing voices. Yeah, I would be doing voices.
And do people like it? Or
no.
No.
But
okay.
I thought they liked it. But I realized in hindsight they didn't like it because what they would say is, oh, that's great. You ought to be in radio. And I always heard it, hey, that's great. You ought to be in radio. And what they were saying is, oh, that's great. You ought to be in radio. Like, get out of here and do it on somewhere else because
this you've got a face for it.
We want to eat.
I think it was probably, this is, you know, you're wasting a great voice feeding us slop.
Please stop feeding us and go work in radio.
Go work in radio.
Shut up and give me the potatoes is what they were saying. But I heard it like you did. I heard it as encouragement. So there was a campus radio station, WYBC, and I went over there. And I was very scared. And they made you audition. So the way you audition, this is in the days of teletype news. So you know, they had the teletypes. AP, UPI, there'd be three or four teletypes in a row. You'd go and you'd look for stories. You had a ruler and you'd rip off the news. It's called rip and read. And
like
then you'd have a sheaf.
UPI or AP machine?
UPI, AP, yeah. Reuters, and you'd have a sheaf of papers. And I can really remember that I was scared because the sheaf was shaking like leaves. And the microphone was an old RCA ribbon mic hanging from the ceiling.
Wow. Yeah.
And they went, and in the news, and then I was really scared. And that was live. It was an audition. Now nobody's listening.
How old were you at this point?
16. 16 wow. or 17. It was a college radio station, so it wasn't
well,
a very...
you were 16 at college.
I went to college at 16, okay. So but this was sophomore year, so I was 17. So I was very nervous, but they were very desperate. So they said, okay, you can keep doing that. And it's very much like, remember that great movie Pitch Perfect? Where she
yes.
goes to the college radio
Available
station.
On HBO Go right now.
It is. It's actually a good movie. But she goes to
you
the...
You also like Glee. Though.
I love Glee. It's,
my nephew,
it's another Glee. It's,
my
know,
nephew,
it's
my 20-year-old for... male football-playing nephew, chose to watch Pitch Perfect.
It's actually
no
quite
prompting.
Funny.
It's,
yeah, no, but I'm, the star I'm of it, she goes like to the it. College radio station, and it was actually a very realistic portrayal. There's a guy in the booth who's a hunk. That was me. And then there's a lot of albums, and he said you can sort the albums. Or actually, there were CDs, but in my day, it was albums. And that's the kind of thing you did. And then you slowly worked your way into radio. But it was music, and I loved playing the music. I wasn't, you know, thinking about it, I wasn't very good as a DJ. You know, this was 1974. There was a lot of good progressive rock. But I'd be playing, like, the Nitty Gritty Dirt Band. And, you know, Blue
Mr.
Oyster
Bojangles.
Cult. Mr. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it was terrible. I was I thought I was with it and hip, but as you know, Sarah, my musical tastes are not too sophisticated. So.
Well, you're also what a 17-year-old in college with a. I mean.
Yeah, let's talk about like, that. Now you're saying like. Oh,
so you
I'm
asked me how I was. I was very nerdy.
How did you get to go? How did you end up? Because you grew up in California, right?
Yeah. No. I was born in Rhode Island.
Right.
Or born in New York.
Where did you grow up?
Grew up in Rhode Island till through ninth grade. And then in 10th grade, my dad got a job at UC California, Santa Cruz. So we all moved in 1971 to UC California.
So you
but
finished
then you
high school here
for
early?
Very long.
No.
How do you do that?
I went to high school sophomore and junior year in Santa Cruz, and the counselor said, you can graduate now. And I said, I'll see you, because that was my high school. So that's
and
why
you
I was
just
so
on
young.
The young side
and how
were
you able
is.
To graduate early? Why was that?
Because I had all the credits I needed. Because I went to a better school in Rhode Island, and I guess I had more credits. So Santa Cruz High.
So it was the move from Rhode Island.
You've taken
to Santa
English.
Cruz.
You could graduate. So they
you
let me
speak
out.
English.
You could speak
properly.
English
properly.
That's good. Yeah, everybody was surfing, and I was like, so. And they said you can. I graduated like suddenly, so I quickly had to do applications, and I applied to Harvard, Yale, Brown, Princeton, Reed in Portland, Oberlin in Ohio. And I got into everything except Harvard, and I'll never forgive you, Harvard. I didn't get into Harvard, but I'd gotten all of those. I should probably, in hindsight, have gone to Reed, where Steve Jobs was, or Oberlin, you know, great small liberal arts schools. But, you know, you get into Yale, I got into Yale, so I had to go.
Well, that's also a very good school.
Well, and your parents obviously were supporting you very well if you were able to apply to all those schools. I mean, that's a
it
nice
cost
selection.
$10 each in those days. It wasn't an elaborate
thing.
That's a
lot of money back then.
That was when a dollar was a real. You could buy a steak dinner for $5.
1974.
Yeah.
A penny. Fill up your car.
So, hey, no, but, you know, I couldn't get into Yale today. It was not as difficult.
Do you think it was part of that graduating early helped your
there was
application?
I was a straight A student at Santa Cruz High because it was just stupid. And I played chess fairly well, and so I had a hobby. And I did, you know, I don't know. I somehow skated in. I got good SATs.
Yeah, I mean, a straight-A student who plays chess, usually, those are dummies. Like,
I
why
skated
would anyone,
in.
Why would anyone
I
want
skated
that?
In. I got in, and I got good recommendations. Whatever. I'm still to this day shocked. But I would not get in today. It's much more competitive
But
now.
You weren't a computer science major.
No, because when I went to Yale, computers were in the basement, and you'd use punch cards. It was not at all interesting. But one of the guys, the station manager at the radio station, I was more interested in that anyway. I wasn't into computers yet. Chess was the closest thing to that. Mm-hmm. I really wanted to be an actor, and the radio station kind of fulfilled me a little bit on that. And one of the guys there was building an Altair, so it was that era. He was an early, in fact, he runs Elecraft, which is a ham radio company, and he started Mountain Computing, which is a hard drive company. Stay in touch with Eric.
But you were majoring in what, Chinese studies?
I majored in Chinese, yeah.
In Chinese. And so, where, I mean, you wanted to be an actor. There's a radio station.
I was very confused.
You had a really good school.
I was very confused.
Did you kind of just, like, point to something?
Yeah, so you were a normal kid.
See, you, it's
plus
interesting.
You're young, too.
Because you, Sarah, obviously, you studied TV and you got into TV. You knew what you wanted to do.
Yeah.
I had no idea. I knew I didn't want to be an actor because I didn't want all that rejection. I didn't want to audition for stuff. I wanted to be an actor. Yeah. I really wanted to be
You didn't want to have
an actor.
To go through the process.
I think we probably have all kind of
And I'm a good actor.
Right?
I later studied acting, and I've appeared in a number of plays and stuff. And I think I'm a decent actor. Mm-hmm. And I maybe even could have made it as an actor, but I wasn't.
I think it's one of the things that makes you a good host is that.
This is acting. You know that. I mean, this is acting.
Yeah.
In fact, it's more fun kind of acting.
He's nothing like this, actually. Oh, wait, we have drop cams.
He's actually a 65-year-old woman. No one knows.
I'm Mrs. Doubtfire.
It's very shy and
it's
mousy.
It's the opposite.
When the lights go off.
I strap my large breasts down so that they don't sway.
Sometimes they still come up.
I know.
That's called acting.
Sometimes.
I'm a method actor.
Yeah. You're a methadone actor.
So, what were we saying?
So why did you choose Chinese? Was it a dartboard or?
I had to do a language.
Yeah.
I tried Greek and it was too hard. And I thought,
Chinese is known as
Chinese is easy. I'll do something easy like Mandarin.
It's a lot easier than Greek. So it is. So In my sophomore year, you have to declare end of sophomore year, because I needed to take a language. I dropped Greek and I took Chinese, intensive Chinese, and I loved it. And I also really was more interested in being a history major. And this Chinese studies is you pick a discipline like history plus Chinese. So it was Chinese plus history was what my actual major was. And it was fascinating. I really liked
this
it.
This was a long time ago, but. And China is obviously not.
It wasn't open then.
Yeah. Superpower, but did
no,
you have,
no, but it
Nixon
was a superpower.
Gone to China
did you have any
yes.
inkling yeah. that you know what? One day, I'm not just choosing Chinese because I think it's going to be less difficult than Greek.
I didn't. Yes, that's why I chose it. I didn't choose it thinking, oh, someday there'll be a superpower and it'll be useful.
Hmm.
No idea. And you know, when people said, well, what do you want to do? I said, well, I'll either, I don't know, teach Chinese or work in the State Department. It's got to be. There's something here. I don't know.
Yeah.
Was it the
My parents never
system?
Said, you need to get a job and have an education and plan your life. They never said that. They just said, I don't care. Go ahead. Do whatever you want.
And at that time, Buddhism and Taoism and Zen and all of that was very starting.
That could have been some of it.
Popular.
Yeah, it was
Did
the hippie generation.
Was that an attraction?
Possibly. I don't think so. I think it was a couple of things. One, it's the oldest recorded history that we have. It goes way, way back, 5,000 BC. So
first explorers, first navy, all of that.
Yeah, it's fascinating culture. It's also very alien. And I think that what I thought at the time, or at least what I said to myself at the time, is I want to study a culture that is not Western, that is very different, not to look at the difference, but to look at the commonality. See, what the human experience is, even in a culture that is completely alien to ours. And so I was very interested in what is in common between our two cultures. In fact, that was what my thesis was going to be, was feudalism in Western society and Chinese society, a comparison of the two.
So how long did your extreme interest in this last?
About 6 months.
And then
what happened is when I went to the campus radio station in my sophomore year, first semester of junior year, go back to school, continue Chinese, but spent a lot of time at the radio station, then some more time at the radio station. Pretty soon I started not going to class and started going to the radio station all the time. And by the end of my first semester, my junior year, I'd basically flunked out because I had just stopped going to class and I was probably by then the program director of the radio station. I was really having fun. And I just kind of irresponsibly just stopped going to school, basically.
You're doing what you wanted to do.
Well, you know, it's funny. I went to my reunion, my 35th reunion some years ago, and I said, I feel kind of like an interloper here. I only did 2.5 years, and not even really that half. And one of my roommates said, no, you did exactly what you're supposed to do in college. You came to college, you found something you really loved, and you pursued it. Mm-hmm. And it didn't happen to be under the curricular umbrella of what Yale offered. They didn't have a radio class.
But if you hadn't gone, it might not have worked out the way it did. Too.
Yeah, I'm not second guessing it.
Yeah.
And for a while, I thought, I really wish I had a degree. And I no longer. Nobody. It's never at any point in my career has anybody said, why don't you have a BA? Where's your degree? Nobody ever says that to you. Well, you guys have degrees.
We have degrees, but you know. And
there are definitely positions you cannot get. Without a degree.
But nothing
or
I ever applied for.
Or even a master's degree, but exactly.
Especially in
I couldn't
this
be
business.
An editor at a magazine, but
I mean, most people don't have broadcasting
degrees. Or right. You couldn't get an executive management job, you know, or something like
that. I never was interested. I didn't want to do that. I wasn't interested in business. I wasn't interested in sales.
You can't run Yahoo. That's for sure.
Well, you
and
could
isn't
for
it
a
interesting
while.
That most of the entrepreneurs we know are dropouts?
Right.
That's very, very common, as in my generation particularly. Gates and Jobs are most notably.
So you can't continue to be program director at the radio station. You were program.
You can, because it wasn't so tightly connected to the university.
So did you stick around?
I did. In fact, so what I said is, okay, I screwed up. Let me take a year off. Work at the radio station. I actually became the station manager. It was a paying job, not a very great paying job, but I'm going to do this for a year, and then I'll come back, because I could have come back. And then I just never came back. I just did that, and then I kept doing that, and I did it some more, and then I came. Then I.
How long were you still at the
I actually stayed at Yale long enough to watch my class graduate in 77.
You finished your own coursework.
Well,
it just wasn't recognized.
I'm standing in the doorway of the dining hall where I've just washed the dishes.
At the time.
In my uniform, watching my class go down and graduate, I was a little bit like, what did I do?
Well, at the time, I'm sure, because you don't know how it's going to turn out.
You don't know how it's going to turn out.
Yeah.
In hindsight, absolutely turned out fine. Eventually, I stayed there a few more months and eventually came back to Santa Cruz, moved back home, looking for a job in radio. And I thought, oh, it'll be easy, because I've run a radio station, been a program director, station manager.
Mm-hmm.
And it was not, because they go, you have experience, right? I worked at College Station, ran it for 2.5 years.
It's funny how
that
they don't count
that.
That
doesn't count at all. No. You know, too.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So basically, you have to talk somebody into giving you a job, because as far as they're concerned, you've never done this before.
So what people want is for you to be an intern at some sort of a
station. No, there were no internships. These radio stations at this level are so impoverished. There's nothing.
So you just would have had to start over.
I did.
Over.
And
did
so what you do is I went to work at KUSP in Santa Cruz, which is a public radio station, just to make more tapes, because you still need tapes.
Mm-hmm.
It was easier to get because it was public?
It was public. That was volunteer. So I volunteered. It wasn't a paid job. And I did radio shows there for a while and made tapes and just went around. And I finally found the crappiest station I could find. I started at stations, you know, decent stations in Santa Cruz and San Jose. Worked my way down to about the crappiest station I could find, which was I think it was a 1,000-watt daytimer in Monterey. I mean, it's the smallest stations you get. 1,240. AM. So it's like
it goes around the block.
It's way over the right hand side of the dial. It was at the time it was KMBY. And then they changed their call letters to KNRY and this was cool. It was on Cannery Row in Monterey in an old whorehouse, and they had their antenna was in the water. So even though it was only 1,000 watts, it actually propagated pretty well.
Oh, that's interesting.
Anyway, and you could tell it was an old whorehouse because it had lots of little rooms and a balcony overlooking Cannery Row where the girls would hang
out there, and my show's coming up.
Hey, boy.
Hope you
want to hear some Justin Bieber?
Got any requests?
Yeah. Play some Fleetwood Mac.
Oh, okay.
So
were you back living at home?
But that was a real job. It got $700 a month.
Okay, so you were able to.
So I could rent an apartment in Pacific Grove.
Finally.
Didn't have a car, didn't have a TV. I had two roommates, but they were. It was kind of like Three's Company. I had a blonde and a brunette roommate.
You walked 12 miles in the snow.
I did. No, I bicycled down from Pacific Grove to Cannery Row. Right. It actually was beautiful. Actually,
it's not a bad commute.
It was, and $700 was more money then. It's probably the equivalent of $3,000 or $4,000.
What was the format of the station?
It was adult contemporary. Okay. I never worked. I always wanted to work boss radio and rock radio and all that stuff. It was always AC, boring.
Middle of the road.
Yeah, and then what happened? The sad thing that happened was that the station went beautiful music. So I got to be music director there, and I was doing afternoon drive. I started in the middle of the night, but I eventually worked my way up to afternoon. This is very normal in radio. People leave, die, you know, have heart attacks, become drunks.
You advance.
And you rise up through the...
attrition.
Through attrition. It's like a war. And I got a battlefield promotion. But then they went beautiful music, and they said, here's what you're going to say. And they literally wrote out everything you were going to say, and that's it. And I really realized that this is... not a good job, so I quit without a job. And I was very lucky because then I got a job in San Jose, which is a big move up. That's a much bigger market at KLOK.
Even then, it was a big
market. And it was a weekend. You know, you always start at the weekends and you work your way up. In fact, I worked weekends there for a long time. And I remember suddenly getting the courage to call and say, I want a full-time job. And the owner, who now I remind myself of, because he was about my age, and this is kind of like owning a radio station, so I kind of feel like this kind of come full circle. The owner said, okay, and he fired somebody and gave me his job.
Said, there's your job.
There's your job. How do you feel now, kid?
Yeah, Johnny's great. Not coming in on Monday.
I'm sorry, Tom King. I don't know whatever happened to you, but I hope you landed on your feet.
He's probably a drunk.
He's a drunk now.
He's probably working at the whorehouse down the
So then what were you doing full-time?
Radio.
First?
Well, oh, then yeah, I worked at Odyssey Records. Mm-hmm. I worked as a busboy at Denny's. I did a bunch of other day jobs so I could support that and during working weekends in the radio. Actually, they fired me. The only job I've ever been fired from was Odyssey Records. And he said, we're going to fire you because you obviously want to be in radio. You don't want to run a record store. And the future is in records.
Really? I mean, vinyl's back.
Somebody said that to you?
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, he did. But then this guy was kind of a jerk because he fired all the guys and he hired all girls.
He was looking for...
Wow, that's
so he just made it an all-girl record store.
You know what? We're going to fire you because reasons.
And then they went bankrupt because it was a record store.
Great Odyssey.
Remember Odyssey?
No.
So,
I was just saying.
So when did you start being able to support yourself through radio then?
Well, once I was full time at KMBY, I was $700 was a full time job.
No, but in San Jose.
And then in San Jose it was weekends. So then.
A couple of years.
Yeah. Were you living in San Jose, or were you? Driving
no, I was living. I was driving
still?
Over. I think I moved back home, so I could take a weekend job at Clock, and then I was commuting over the hill.
Do you remember?
An Opel Cadet, probably.
An Opel Cadet.
That was my first car.
A Cushman.
It's practically a Cushman. Practically a Studebaker Hawk.
So, okay, so we're seeing the
John got that.
Now, what year is this about at this point? Where are we?
We are in 1978.
So we both lived in Santa Cruz in 1978.
We made out. Did you ever go to the Catalyst?
I was two.
Okay.
But did you ever go to the Catalyst when you were two? Because
I'll have to ask my mom.
I'm just saying.
I made out with a lot of girls back then, and it could have been
of all ages.
Yeah.
Not that
down
young.
Down at the daycare center.
The Catalyst. Yeah. You lived in Santa Cruz in 78?
I was born in Santa Cruz in 1976, and I lived there until 1980.
Yeah, so we overlapped.
Weird.
And then I moved to San Jose and worked there, and then left that job. Actually, I didn't leave that job. The Clock got a station in San Francisco, so I followed them up there.
Mm-hmm.
Commuted for a while, then moved to San Francisco, and then went from Clock to, I don't remember where after that.
KBR. What was your first San Francisco neighborhood that you lived in?
It was on Page Street, 1024 Page Street.
You
I like that address.
Because you picked
it was
me
Page,
up once on Page.
Yeah, it was Page and Frederick.
Okay.
Not Frederick. DeViz,
yep.
Page
yep.
and DeViz,
yep.
And I remembered it because it was 1024 Page, which is a geek joke.
Get it?
Anybody
get it?
In there?
And so that's the address, and I lived there, 1024 Page. It was
call
a 1K
address.
Page. Jeff Needles got it.
Good job, Jeff Needles.
Or he's just typing that to get on my good side. So it was the 1K Page Street, and I lived there, that was, and then moved up to KNBR and
now,
stuff.
Now, did you know that was a geek joke when you moved to 1024?
Yeah, I was, okay, so by then I was
so
into geek gear.
So where does that
gear.
Come in?
So yeah. I got into computers in the late 70s, 78.
Silicon Valley,
it was exciting. It was a really exciting time. And I was into video gaming, so I had Atari, you know, the 2600.
Wait, how did you get into video gaming? Because now
Chuck
that's
E. Cheese,
normal.
Pizza Time Theater.
And what were you doing at Chuck E. Cheese?
I would go there, drop quarters into the Battle Zone game and go...
Yeah, but why? Just killing time?
Because he's...
It was around the corner from the radio
man.
Station.
Oh, okay.
When you're a DJ, you don't have much to do.
No, around the corner from the radio station.
You work
4 hours.
Absolutely. You then go and record commercials after your shift, and then you go home.
And the Chuck E. Cheese is right there. Why not?
The Chuck E. Cheese is on the way. I'm going to stop. I'm going to drop a few quarters, have a Pepsi...
All right, so you're into video games.
Living a wild life.
So I was really into video games. Got an Atari. I said there's more in life than what this can do.
The 2600.
Yeah. So I got an Atari 400, and this is interesting. But it had a flat membrane keyboard. So I got an Atari 800. Started typing in programs from Compute and other magazines. Then I started actually writing software. I convinced the owner of that radio station to buy a Northstar Advantage, which is an early CPM machine.
Nice.
And I wrote software for him where he could. It would make graphs of how the songs were doing on various charts and stuff, and then he'd come in, look at the song, listen to it, and decide where they're at the playlist. Never got enough credit for that. That was a cool program.
They have a North Star at the Digibarn.
Do they really?
Down in Santa Cruz.
Now, the original North Stars were S100 machines. This was the Advantage was a later machine that had vector graphics. It was a big deal. Probably he spent $20,000 on that thing. It was very expensive.
Wow.
And I got him to get a 5 megabyte, not gigabyte, megabyte hard drive. And for $4,000 or $5,000
at all,
1979 or something, 1980. And I got him to get the Whiteside C compiler. And I couldn't figure it out because it just was a bunch of source code. And I finally figured out, you have to bootstrap it. You have to actually build the compiler. You start with this one little thing and you build and build and build. It's more and more elaborate and eventually build the whole system. So I had a C compiler. I had this North Star Advantage. And I really started to get into it. I loved it. And I had been playing chess, so I was into this logic stuff. So it made sense to me. So I just fell in love with it.
Now, did you have a circle of people you were hanging out with doing
this
stuff?
Yeah, there were user groups. I would go to user groups. Yeah. And there, Homebrew was, in Silicon Valley.
Did you go to Homebrew?
Yeah. And there was the Byte Shop. I'd go down to the Byte Shop and stand in the window. And remember when the Lisa came out, and we would look at it and go, if I only had $10,000. And so it was exciting times. I had a friend who worked at Atari, Owen. And he was a programmer there. He wrote, you may remember this, in Asteroids, there's a little volcano that erupts. He wrote that.
No kidding. He wrote the erupting volcano? I definitely remember that.
You remember the volcano?
Yeah.
Little vector graphics.
You feel like the fact that you were physically in Silicon Valley made
a lot
of difference?
If you were there at the time, when you go to New York City and you feel a vibe? It was like that.
Mm-hmm.
There was an energy. There was an excitement. People knew something was happening.
Because the vibe is everywhere now. But at that time,
it was
actually
very specific.
Yeah, it's probably
like South Park. If you go to South Park and everybody's talking about their B-round. And it was just that sense of there was something happening.
Yeah.
And it was very early days. It wasn't... The thing that was very different is it wasn't in any way classy or anything anybody knew about. It was a very much of a subculture.
Yeah.
And it was a very geeky subculture. But if you were in it, it was like Dungeons and Dragons people. If you met another D&D guy, it was great. You could talk. And so it was not like there were Newsweek was writing about it yet or anything like that. It was a subculture.
Well,
there were
barely any magazines.
Exciting.
Yeah.
It was so exciting. And I started to support my habit writing for magazines. So I wrote for Atari magazines. I wrote for Compute. Eventually wrote for Byte and InfoWorld magazine. When the Macintosh came out, I wrote the first Mac software review in 1984.
Now, how did you get those
for InfoWorld
gigs? Was it just you?
There weren't that many
your...
people were into it. It was a lot smaller.
But who did you blind submit, or did you have friends? Do you remember?
I don't remember. I must have had friends. I don't remember submitting anything.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I wrote a letter. I don't know, and said, "Hey, I'd like to review something. You got any software you can give me, or whatever?" I don't remember, to be honest with you. But it was a very natural, it didn't seem like it was hard work. You got to remember, it was small time. So there wasn't this sense of you're trying to break down a door. Unlike radio, where you're breaking it down a door in old media, this was like nobody was interested.
They're like,
so
you care?
Oh, you have a computer?
Yeah,
you care?
Great. We'll publish it.
Great. Yeah. I wrote a column for a Atari magazine for a while, a fiction column.
So
it was just fun.
What was it?
Was it terrible?
Was it your bone byline?
Was it like an alternate universe story?
It was really
story?
A terrible story about Pokey, and it was really bad.
Wait,
it's
what do
embarrassing.
Mean, Pokey from Gumby and Pokey?
No, the Atari API had chips for gaming. There was the Pokey chip, and there was an IO chip.
Ah.
So I had a story about living on the Atari motherboard, and
I was like Tron.
It was terrible. It was so.
You
awful.
Were the predecessor of Tron.
We've got to find that.
Oh, they've already found it.
Yeah. Links, please.
It's online. It's terrible.
I bet it's great.
It's terrible.
So you're living in Silicon Valley. You're getting into computers. You're getting into some C compiling. You're writing columns.
I wrote C. C was the first language that I learned, and I loved. Well, no, I learned Basic, but then I learned C, and I fell in love. I still have my original KNR. It's all beat up C book, C programming language. I loved it. I still love it.
And then
when you start looking at it, it's elegant, and you go, it's like seeing a Van Gogh for the first time. Oh my God, this is beautiful.
But you're still doing radio, and that's still your love.
Yeah, so it's separate paths.
When you ended up in San Francisco, were they as receptive to you, to your technology?
Yeah, I mean, I was still writing. I had one of the early Macintosh bulletin boards in 1984, 85, 86.
Ran that out of your house?
Ran out of my house, Mac Hugh.
Nice.
On dial-up, we had two lines, no waiting. I actually had to write a write a program, a demon dialer, because you could never get in. It was always busy. So I wrote QDialer, and I think it was the first multitasking program ever written on a Mac. It was kind of sophisticated. It used the vertical blank interval on the screen. So, you know, on these old screens, it would draw the screen, then it would get here, it would go back down and draw it again. So yeah. There was a moment, very brief moment in time, when the electron gun is repositioning, that's called the vertical blank interval, and the processor's not doing anything at that moment. So you can wait for the VBI and then do something really quick and then let it go again. So it's the only way you could multitask. It's like, because otherwise the machine's busy, it's drawing. So you'd wait for the VBI, and then you could put a few numbers into the dialing register for the modem, then wait for it again, put a few more in, Eventually you fill it up, now you can dial. Then every time there's a VBI, you say, am I online? And if you are, then you, and I had a big noise. I went, because you had to let the user know, who's busy doing Mac Paint, that you're online. Otherwise, you just keep dialing. And it would dial for hours, constantly, until it got online. So I called it the Q dialer.
This was dialing out from your computer.
This was the end user would download this program, put it on their Mac,
and then
to get into my BBS.
The
BBS was called Mac Q, because you were always waiting in line to get on the thing. And the program was called Q Dial. It was written in assembler.
Q,
the letter Q, but it was based on it.
Bad marketing. I mean,
no, that's good marketing. What are you talking about?
Please
line branding.
Up. There will always be a line here. But
I thought it was clever.
But at the time.
Q-dial.
No, it's
better than some of the names.
No, QDial is a great name for
the program. It was the BBS that everybody wanted to get into. It was so popular you couldn't get into it.
Because nobody had a Mac. I mean, because nobody had a Mac BBS.
Right, there were a handful of them. It was a Fido BBS.
I mean, this is what you said, 1985? This is very early days for this stuff.
Something like that,
I mean, probably a lot of people that you try to explain this to would say,
found,
I have no idea.
I found a posting the other day. I was looking around on the internet. You've heard of it.
Yeah.
And I found a posting that Guido Van Rossum, before he wrote Python, posted, I read this rumor on Mac Q. Leo Laporte says that the next Macintosh is going to be this.
So you were doing Mac rumors before they were
cool. Yeah. And the guy who wrote Python, before he wrote Python, made a note of it, and I had no idea who this guy was.
Where did you find this?
Like I said, the internet, it's a vast trove.
Weird.
I don't remember what I was Googling.
You were Googling yourself.
I was trying to find Mac Q. No, we were talking about it on the radio show, and I was trying to find what years was Mac Q. Eventually, I got tired of running, and I gave it to the Berkeley Macintosh users group. They continued it on. I gave them the hard drives.
Hey, you know what, Leo? I don't mean to interrupt, but this episode of Triangulation is brought to you by Bespoke Post.
Do you get a Bespoke Post in here?
I just got my first one.
Did you? It's so awesome. What'd you get?
I got things.
Just do this.
Whole spice.
Smell this. Do you like mustard?
Love it.
Or ketchup?
Mine didn't have that.
No, there's different, all different.
Give it.
Mine had awesome drinks.
That's the world's best. No, that's the point.
Yeah.
So every month you get a different gift, and you have a couple you can choose from. This is the barbecue one. See these? Do you ever barbecue, Tom?
No, I don't.
Hickory? You put a fish on there, you soak this in water, you put it on the... This is what's cool about Bespoke. It introduces you to new ideas. They have shaving, they have socks, just a variety of different stuff. $45 a month.
Brooklyn.
It's a great gift for a guy. It's designed for guys, but I mean, I don't see any reason why a woman wouldn't want
women like
spice.
Mustard, too.
You like spice rubs and pepper and all that stuff?
Some of my best friends are
but
women.
Mostly it's around guys, I guess. You get your box of awesome every month. It's a great gift. And you can get 20% off your first box, bespokepost.com/twit. I just love getting this every month. It's like Christmas every month.
Custom made.
Merry Christmas, Sarah Lane.
Thanks, Leo. Gosh,
we got another box for you, Tom. Actually,
barbecue
there's over there.
A fish. Yeah, mine has martini. It has glasses.
They
and
knew that
bar
you were more
wear.
Of a. Yeah, that you were more of the.
I guess it is.
Honey
is bespoke.
It's good honey too.
Everyone
it's really
likes
good
honey.
Thank you, dear. So I'm seeing the theme. Early into college, chess, teach yourself C.
It was logic, yeah.
Dumb guy.
Yeah.
Don't know.
There you see, they found it. Look at that. Atari magazines.
Nice. Atari magazines.
It's fashion. Horrible.
Oh, Pokey? The story of Pokey on the motherboard?
Yeah.
So you were still doing music when you went to San Francisco?
Yeah. My first job was Clock. We took over the old, I think it was KKSF. In fact, you know that right on the air sign I have in my office? That was a hippie AO album-oriented rock station, AOR station, and they left. They said, "Okay, you know, your station, goodbye." That literally, the DJ played his last song, and then left. I said, "Wait a minute, dude, do you want your right on the air sign?" He said, "No, you can have it." I said, "I'll take it." And so that's from there, and then and so the concept of this new station, Clock FM, there it is. This
right
was
on.
This is a bit of San Francisco memorabilia.
I mean,
yeah,
this, it is.
This was a big was San Francisco station in the album rock era. So, but this is the worst. This is how sad my life was. The new station, Clock FM, the motto was, build your own radio station. You've always wanted to. Build your own radio station. You've always wanted to.
It's like Pandora.
Clock FM is you. And then, no, it's not like Pandora. So
and
here's how
goes,
it worked.
What?
We're going to start with one artist.
Uh-huh.
Neil Diamond.
Oh.
And we played Neil Diamond songs only for the first 24 hours. That's me.
But
for 4 hours.
Okay.
Playing Holly Holy
Rose.
Yeah. So then the jingle, build your own radio station. Now we're gonna choose our second artist. You could choose from Barry Manilow or Barbara Streisand. The votes come in. And so the operators. And this is how I met Cammie Blackstone. She was one of the people answering the phone. She said, "Hello, I vote for Barry Manilow." Okay. And then at the end of the voting, we went to make a big announcement. Our second artist, Barry Manilow.
Yeah.
Then Barbara
he
Streisand.
He only had a 50% chance of winning.
Yeah, well, we set it up. There was no chance of, you know.
But
even
No Santana music.
Build was, a station
and
you've
I did not,
always
this
wanted.
This is not the music of my
From
choice. This is
choices.
Nothing I would love. Yeah, but it was Kenny Rogers Berry. It was album, what do you call it?
Adult Contemporary.
Adult Contemporary.
Yeah.
And the only reason I was on Adult Contemporary is, unlike any other station, the DJ could kind of talk. You would tell stories. You'd say, "Oh, there's a new baby boy. Boy George has been born," and, you know, stuff like that. that's how old it is.
Yeah.
And he's bald now, you know, Boy George. Sad.
He's a lot of things.
Yeah.
So many things.
Come, we did play Boy George music later on. We got a little
Culture
hipper.
Club. They
Culture
were,
Club.
They were
huge.
Very big. I had the cassette.
So that was the only reason I did it is because I could do it was personality radio, so I could do a little personality. Then I went to KMBR, which was middle of the road and much more personality. That was exciting. That was a big move. That was a big station, not only in terms of size, but just a reputation. It was one of San Francisco's great old
This is a sports
radio
station now, but it wasn't then.
It wasn't then. It was what they called full-service MOR, which means you played a little music, but it had Frank and Mike in the morning, Carter B. Smith in the afternoon. It was very personality. And over time, I was able to make, at KNBR, the transition from music. I got to the point where I only played one song an hour to talk. So I'd do interviews and stuff, and the amount of music on my show just dwindled away
just
to nothing.
Just general talk, though?
At first I did cultural stuff, so I interviewed any book author. It wasn't, by the way, a big ratings grabber. But I did 5 interviews a day for years and interviewed probably in that time, 2,000 or 3,000 people.
Mm-hmm.
Met every author. You know, people like John Cleese would come to town. A Fish Called Wanda just came out, and I spent an hour talking to John Cleese about this. I have some great memories. Walter Cronkite.
Oh, wow.
Just amazing people. And I really loved doing that.
But was City Arts and Lectures happening back then?
No,
I mean,
but it
is
was
that
kind
why people
of
were
like
coming
that.
In to...
No, they were just, they would tour. Like,
yeah.
Walter Cronkite's new sailing book came out, so we would tour. In those days, the book tour was very much how they publicized books.
Mm-hmm.
They don't do it so much anymore, but in those days, everybody went on a book tour.
Well, they do a lot of book tours, but they don't do it on the radio.
They do satellite book tours.
Or they go to book shops.
Yeah.
I know Scalzi is always on the road.
Right,
promoting stuff.
Because radio doesn't really want to do that anymore. But in those days,
we
use
the internet
to get the
word out. You don't use the radio.
You would get an interview on KGO and you get an interview on KMBR.
Mm-hmm.
And the sad thing is, San Francisco was usually the end of the tour. So I would get these people; they were burnt out, they were exhausted.
Yeah, yeah.
30 days on the road, same 6 questions over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
So it really took that as a challenge to have a conversation. I think I'd really honed my interviewing skills because, they give you the list of questions, and I just would never. I throw them away. And I always just wanted to have a conversation. And that, to me, was the best job ever. I loved it. But the ratings were terrible. So finally they called me. And one of the guys I interviewed, by the way, during this period was John C. Dvorak.
Mm-hmm.
And this was the first time
columnist
I'd ever come
John
out of... Yeah, he was a computer columnist. But the first time I'd ever kind of come out of the closet that was interested in computers, I'd never mentioned it on the air. And this would probably be 88 or 89. 88 probably. And May 89, because the earthquake was 89, and I was still at KNBR then. So eventually, probably around 90, this guy named Rush Limbaugh is doing pretty well in Sacramento. Mm-hmm. And then they syndicated him, and KNBR, which was under new ownership, used to be NBC, and it was purchased by a China company, Susquehanna Faultscraph. You ever have any Faultscraph China? It's lovely.
No.
They really shouldn't be in the radio business, per se, but they were. They wanted to diversify.
Yeah, well, that was the thing, right? You gotta, I mean, you know, Illinois Central Railroad bought Tet Milk when my dad was
Yeah, exactly.
That was the time. Yeah.
Exactly. So they bought radio, a few radio stations from NBC. That was a sad day. But Rush Limbaugh came along, and I was doing middays, and they said, you know, Leo, this guy's really eating it up on the ratings. People seem to really like him. No San Francisco station has him. We'd like to carry him. That means you're out of work. But we like you, so we want you to do weekends and do specialty programming. It was really the kiss of death. I did 2 9-hour air shifts, Saturday and Sunday.
And brutal.
Horrible. And I did Home Improvement for 2 hours, then I do Food and Wine for... And yeah. Then an expert. So the Home Improvement experts were the Carey Brothers, and the Food and Wine with Anthony Dias Blue. And then, so I would do these shows one after the other, and I said, okay, but can I do a computer show for 2 hours? And they said, nobody's going to be interested in that. But they said, please, just give me 2 hours so I don't go crazy. So they did, and Dvorak came in every Saturday.
Was that on computer?
Well, it wasn't yet, but that was the idea.
Birth of it?
Yeah, it was
okay.
The birth of it. It was me and Dvorak. And John, who I really credit with my career, let me be more of a computer expert. On these other shows, that's, you know, let's introduce our guests and then take some calls. And I would be the guy who would handle the calls and they would answer the questions.
Yeah.
I was just an
announcer.
You were
just softballing.
Yeah. I wasn't even softballing.
You're the presenter.
Joe in Fremont, what do you want? I got termites in the wall. Well, let me tell you about Visqueen. Not me, but the guy. You know. Mm-hmm. And then so they'd go on, and then I'd do the commercials and stuff. It was just really, but John, A, because he was probably lazy, and B, because he started to realize I actually knew what I was talking about, let me more and more. So if it weren't for him, he was the guy who let me be a computer whiz. And eventually we did syndicate that. Got on like 60 stations. It wasn't a hugely successful syndication, but we did it for a little while. And that really is, I never went back. That was, from that point on, it was always technology.
So when you left KNBR, it was to start doing technology stuff?
Well, my departure from KNBR was a little bit fragmented because we'd had Abby, my baby girl, in March of 92. And I cut back to 3 days a week. I was doing the radio, the weekend shows, and then I was writing commercials and recording them a couple of days a week. So maybe it was 4 days a week.
Where were you living at this point?
Out on Moraga and 27th.
Okay. So you're still in San Francisco?
Sunset.
Old Fog Town.
Oh, it's cold. I never forget the 4th of July party where we had to get people mittens and sweaters and
yep.
We put logs in the grill and they're huddling around there.
He's not kidding, folks.
Ironically, that was the day Abby was conceived, but that's a story for another time.
Name her mittens. That's good. I'm glad. Would have been horrible.
A year later, I don't remember what I'm talking about.
You were leaving KNBR in a fragmented
Android. No, I was still at KNBR.
Had a baby.
And CNET called me.
Uh-huh.
Halsey Miner and Shelby Bonney were two hedge fund guys out of New York who wanted to put some money, and they were interested in doing a technology television network. And Halsey called me and said, "You're the guy," because I was doing Stavorak and computers. It was the only computer show, and he said, "You know this stuff. We'd like you to be our vice president of programming. I'm going to fly out." They were still in New York at the time, and we met. And Halsey was one of those guys who was either loved you or he hated you, and he would flip on a dime. Did you ever work for CNET?
I worked for CNET, yes, but I never worked for Halsey.
Never worked for Halsey.
No.
He'd flip on a dime. So I worked for him briefly. I went from his fair-haired boy to his evil spawn of Satan. And, you know, he just really kind of... I made a pilot for them, which was a roundtable show with John C. Dvorak, Fred Davis, who was a computer journalist, Stuart Alsop, who was a very well-known computer journalist, Gina Smith, and I. And we sat around a roundtable. It was very much like TWiT. It was actually... I've been a big fan of the McLaughlin Group, and it was kind of the McLaughlin mm-hmm. Group about computers. We did a pilot. Then they hired a guy from L.A. who was a TV expert. I can't remember his name. I'm probably blanking it out. And he said, "This is a horrible, horrible thing." But
like a consultant.
It was a consultant, Hollywood guy. So I had already told Halsey. Halsey said, "Do the due diligence on starting a television network." And I said, "Halsey, you're talking you're going to lose money for the first 10 years. It's guaranteed. You'll probably lose as much as $50 million a year for 10 years. It's literally, you're going to be sinking $500 million into this. Now, CNN, after 10 years, turned the corner, was in the black and made money, but you have to be prepared to be in the red for that long. And he said, we're not doing a TV network. And it was actually good advice. I was right. And had I given the same advice to Tech TV, then ZD might not have done it, because it was about the same numbers for them. So, you know, 8 years later.
Well, and ZDNet, Ziff Davis, kind of did the opposite thing, where they were starting the websites first and then
right.
decided
then
to
went
do
to
the
TV.
Television.
And that's where Halsey showed his brilliance, because he decided not to do TV, but to do CNET, the website, and support it with small occasional shows.
Well, and the other brilliance, this is just a total side note, but Frank Voci told me this story. He was the assistant who they had register CNET.com, and they asked him how much it was. He's like, oh no, it's free, because it was free to register domain. They're like, it's free? Register radio.com, oh. broadcast.com, kids.com. Oh. They told him to like register every word you
all
could
think of. All the generic words.
That's how CNET ended up with all those domain names.
Yeah. Which weren't smart. That useful, as it turned out. Something like TV.com is less valuable than one would think.
These days,
it's generic.
Because it wasn't used,
right.
And so, yeah, now nobody right. identifies it.
So, Halsey eventually, I didn't hear from him. At one point, he finally called me, and by this time, they had moved to San Francisco. They had their old place over by where the Bay Club used to be with the railroad car, and he called me into his railroad car office, and basically said, well, it's been nice. He didn't ever fire me or anything. But he said, you know, here's a press release from Ziff Davis. They want to do TV. You should call them. That was his way of saying.
Yeah.
So I went out the door and I called him. And flew to New York to meet with Bill McCrone, who was the editor-in-chief of PC Magazine at the time. And a guy they'd hired, who was a TV expert named Gary. Gary, I'm sorry, I forgot your last name. I talked to him all the time. And they interviewed me, and I knew things like Arbox and C-Lex. I was laying it on thick. Yeah, well, you know, if the R-Box have anything to do with it, you're never going to see the ISPs on the West Coast and the thing. And they were very impressed, because they didn't know what the hell I was saying. And they hired me. They
like,
said,
we've
okay.
We've heard these words. We don't know
what they
mean.
We would like you to work for us. And the plan was...
Now, was John writing for PC Mag by that point?
Yes.
Okay.
The plan was, and I think I was still doing the radio show with John at this time, that they were going to buy airtime. This was a very bad plan. On CNBC, and they were going to do a half-hour editorial show called The Personal Computer Show. Mm. Am I going on too long?
No, this is great.
Okay. I feel like I've been talking
a lot.
Tell
him if he's going on too long.
The Personal Computing Show, and then they would do a half-hour show called Computer Shopper that would be a computer shopping show that would pay for the editorial. So they suck you in with editorial, and then they do a half-hour shopping. It didn't work. And so they were buying time on CNBC and a bunch of other places. It was Jim Lauterbach and Gina Smith hosted the Personal Computing Show. They were sitting on a green screen in stools, and they had recorded the office of... She owned a clothing store that begins with an E, a big clothing brand that's gone...
Emporium?
No, it was Elite or... anyway, it was a beautiful office that they recorded half an hour. And they would just play it, and it would loop, and the wind would blow. And it was very pretty. And Gary didn't really like Jim that much. And I was the technical... I was, as always, the technical managing editor, and I was doing little pieces and standing in the back. And Gary was just watching Jim and said, this isn't working. So after about four episodes, they fired Jim and put me in his seat.
And this was airing on CNBC.
Yeah, which didn't endear me to Jim very much. But Jim, I swear to God, I did not lobby for this. It just happened.
What was the show called?
The Personal Computing Show.
The Personal Computing Show, followed
we
by
did,
Computer Show.
We did one season. We did only like 20 episodes.
And it was you and Gina Smith as
Me
host.
And Gina Smith. Mm-hmm. You can probably still find this somewhere. Computer Chronicles had been on for a while. It was that kind of show.
Yeah.
And it was pre-internet. But anyway, they killed it all. But Ziff Davis kept me as a consultant. And I actually made a lot of money doing nothing. Just hanging around, we pretended that
they
we were
interested. They call you up and say, "Does this sound right?"
This
computer
was like
guy?
This. No, they were computer experts. I was the TV expert.
Ah.
So it was like this: MGM wants to do a computer channel. They want to partner with us. We don't really want to do it, but we'd like you to fly down. I had an office on the MGM lot. We'd like you to fly down once a week, pretend that you're developing stuff for MGM and then come back. That's what I did. Stuff like that.
We would like you to ruin the deal for us, please.
Swear to God.
You're like Harry on Mad Men.
It was like cuckoo. It was cuckoo, but it was money. And while I'm doing that, I was able to do new media news. Uh-huh. I did a thing on PBS. I did start to develop my TV chops. I said, well, you know, I got a lot of free time. I'll do new media news and this stuff.
Yeah.
And because that was like one day a week, and there was another one day a week. So that was, thank you, Ziff Davis. I got a full, I was getting paid like $80,000 a year for nothing. But then one Christmas 1995, I think, they called up and say, in 10 days, we're presenting for NBC. They've just done a deal with Microsoft to launch a new channel, and they want a technology hour treatment. So I, during that Christmas week, wrote the treatment for a show. We went to 30 Rock with McCrone and Gary.
Not
and
the television show, Youngsters. He means
the actual building, yeah. 30 Rockefeller Center. Went up to the executive level, and the president of CBS News at the time, Andrew Lack, came in. Beautiful suit with cowboy boots, puts his cowboy boots up on the table and says, what do you got? And so I start presenting the show. My concept was, we have this house where a bunch of people are working on a website, and you're watching them work on a website. Actually, no, I'm sorry. You're watching them work on a TV show.
You still have this idea.
Yeah, this is the one idea I ever had, by the way. I just keep doing it. You can watch them work. You can see what they're listening to, blah, blah, there's spy cams. And then at the end of the day, you got a TV show, a half-hour TV show about what's going on in technology. So it's like this this was before Big Brother. It was like this multi-tier play where you have a website, you can watch what they're doing.
But the
every once in a
real.
While, they'll turn to the camera and say, hey, I'm working on this story, let me tell you what I'm working on. And at the end of the day, on the network, on MSNBC, because it was supposed to be a daily tech show, an hour, you got the show.
You edited it down.
Yeah. And then McCrone came on, so I pitched for half an hour this show. McCrone comes on, says, here's the business deal. The title of our pitch was The Revolution Will Be Televised. It was, you know, it was all the cliches, but it wasn't cliche at the time because nobody had ever done anything like this. This is 1995, nobody's even got a browser yet. I mean, this is all pretty new, or 94. You know, it was 94. It was 94 because we did it for 18 months. So at the end of the presentation, Lack looks at David Borman, who's a senior vice president at NBC, and you know him because, well, we'll meet him again later.
He comes back into the story later.
He comes back into the story several times. And he looks to David Borman and says, why don't you guys ever bring me anything like this? He loved it. Now, again in hindsight, I'm really good at not understanding what's going on until like days, weeks, or months later. But I think in hindsight I realized there was no way we could fail on this pitch. The whole deal was they needed something to pretend it was a tech channel for Microsoft. So whatever the hell Ziff Davis said, they were going to say yes.
Brilliant.
Brilliant. So, but I didn't know that. So I went out, I smoked a cigar in the streets of Manhattan. I've made it in New York. We're going to do a show. And they had promised me...
The revolution will be televised.
Yeah, baby. Yeah. And they had promised me, they said, if you do this, you will be managing editor and chief correspondent of the show. And I was very excited. So by the time we actually, so we bought what eventually became the Tech TV studios, or leased
York Street,
and painted a beautiful mural, which was lost, alas, of the San Francisco skyline with billowing sails. Although I remember David, who ended up being the liaison, David Borman was the guy who ran this for NBC, came and moved to San Francisco. The first iteration of the mural, he said, that looks like a big ass. The spinnakers, and he was right. When you got back here, it was just a giant buttock. So this beautiful mural that this artist had spent weeks
beautiful
painted yeah. over, right. do it again. It eventually became the green screen cove for Tilda and Dash. Yeah. So that was that wall. And they hired a woman named Kathy, who had been executive producer of the NBC Nightly News and was burnt out. Like shell-shocked, like post-traumatic stress syndrome.
Wow.
If you watched the newsroom, it was that woman 10 years from now, where she's got not a nerve in her body. She's like...
This is her softball assignment.
Peter Jennings killed me. And this was like, this is it. Like, this
Tom
is her,
Brokaw,
this is like, it was Tom Brokaw. I can't remember, it was, anyway, whoever. She might have worked for another network and NBC brought her in. It was very sad. She was a nice, very nice woman. She wasn't that old. She was probably 40. but she was burnt out. But she put together this thing, probably thinking, what the hell am I doing in San Francisco? Because you got to understand, these New York types, they are in the boonies. This is not where we do TV. There was no network production out of San Francisco. This is unheard of.
There still isn't, really.
Yeah, there still isn't. So it was really kind of an unusual thing for NBC to do. Mm-hmm. They had an anchor that they had hired from NBC, from Cron, named Soledad O'Brien. And she was going to be the next big thing for several reasons. She was black, but she had an Irish surname and a Hispanic first name. Bingo! Golden! This woman cannot fail. She covers every checkbox on there. So, and she was talented. She was smart. Soledad's wonderful, but you've probably seen her. She's old school news, mm-hmm. where not any emotion creeps through. No,
yeah. Yeah.
It's very buttoned down.
Mm-hmm.
And but the site was going to... Oh, by the way, they couldn't come up with a name. So they finally came up with the most generic name they could, which was The Site. Remember, this was going to be a website that you watched on TV, and then you'd watch the TV show. They changed it completely.
I have a pog with The Site logo.
Okay, so there's a story behind these. This is actually kind of funny. When we first started the site, we went to Cafe... This is boring as hell, I'm sorry. But now you got me started. I got 15 more years, so hang in there. I went to Cafe Trieste, the most famous, oldest espresso bar in San Francisco.
Yep, down North Beach.
And they were going to lend us one of their beautiful espresso machines, but they said, but you can't do this unless you send somebody down to learn how to do this. So I went to Cafe Trieste, and I learned... Did you go too, Karsten? Karsten also went. And we learned how to do it. And from the nice lady who spoke no English, she was a nice Italian, old Italian lady, taught me how to do it. And then she says, okay, go, do it. And I said, what do you mean? She said, work. So I'm in Cafe Trieste going, what would you like? And I remember vividly a guy saying, you don't really work here, do you? I said, no, I don't know what I'm doing. But I learned from this lady how to make espresso. So you got free espressos, right, Karsten? We'd come over and get free espressos.
And free Odwalla.
Well, and that was the other thing. They had a refrigerator loaded with Odwalla. Now, this was when Odwalla first came out. You remember the pasteurization scare?
Yeah.
They're now pasteurized, but in the early days of Odwalla, it wasn't, and people got sick. Yeah. Anyway.
Thrown by Coca-Cola now, too. So.
Right. This was when it was first, it was Santa Cruz, and it was just started, fresh juice. And there were about, 40 people, you think, working there? And they 60. The Odwalla guy would come, load the refrigerator. By the end of the day, it's gone. It's free Odwalla. It was gone. So eventually, they came up with a system where you'd get a certain number of Odwalla dollars, and you could buy an Odwalla. And that's it from The Site. And that was the logo. It was like a Vornado that said The Site.
Or Sharknado.
Yeah, Sharknado.
How many did you get? How many chips did you get per week?
Karsten saved them, so obviously you did not spend them on Odwallas. But it was fun. So the way they shot this show, it's a daily show, is it would take them all day to make this one. Was it a half an hour or an hour? It was an hour, right?
An hour.
It was an hour. So it was, and it wasn't, she wasn't even doing all the show, because most of the show was prepackaged, was raps, mm-hmm. it was a shot. So she was just doing raps. Took her all day to do raps, because they were perfectionists. We had Donna Wright Somerville, whose husband, Frank Somerville, is still on KTVU as an anchor.
Yeah.
And she was the floor producer. And Soledad would do it again and again and again. They would do 8 takes for every rap. And it would take them the whole time. The only time Soledad had any fun, I'm convinced, although she might argue, was she would come over to the bar and talk to me. But I wasn't there. I was in another room surrounded with blankets and wearing a suit that had dots on it that was attached to a Silicon Graphics Onyx computer. And Karsten and his cohort Christine were my puppeteers. And I was a barista. So this is what happened. David Borman comes to me at the beginning of the show before we go on the air and says, I just came back from New York. I talked to the executives at NBC. And we were talking about you. I said, oh, what'd they say? Because I'm supposed to be chief correspondent, right? What'd they say? They said, ugh. I said, what? They said, Leo, ugh. I said, well, what does that mean? He said, they're not going to put you on the air. I said, but this is my deal. I'm chief correspondent and managing editor. He said, we're going to make you technical managing editor, which means nothing. Like, I review the scripts and go, no, it's pronounced DOS. And
not Linux.
Not Linux. And by the way, we got Linus Torvalds on the show. We got, because of me, we got some really great stuff. That was Glenn Rubenstein, who was over there. It was 16 years old. told me about MP3s. We did the first segment. Ed Bott still talks about this. I said, hey, Ed, there's this thing called MP3s. All the kids are doing it now. I mean, it was exciting because it was. I remember Kim Polese coming over to talk about something new called Java that she and her friends at Sun were creating. I mean, it was really exciting. But I got none of it because NBC said, this guy, he's ugly. We don't want him on our television. So Borman says, but I got a consolation prize.
It's not a Freehud Wally.
It ain't one of these. You're going to be a virtual character. And it was the first regularly appearing virtual character. Later, Al Franken actually mocked me in one of his books. There she is, Soledad, on the site set. It was a beautiful
set. It's that point in the show where we turn to Dev.
Would that be the high point or the low point? I mean, where exactly?
Which is you're leaving exactly. It so open for me. I can't even go there.
I like, well, Karsten's like to give you the opportunity to slam me right at the beginning.
Christine's
so
doing
that people won't
the
get mad when
face.
I
and I'm doing the hands and the voice.
But so far, you have yet to take me up on this. You're so polite. You're so polite.
What are you doing this here? What are you doing, Karsten?
You just
well,
make
watch.
Me crazy.
And a bit he'll spin it or something.
Hey, I got a great bit for you. This is a great bit.
You want to say that?
Hey. That's to get your attention. Hey, I know you're not exactly
like
thrilled
really
to be here, so
I'm just
trying to get your attention.
It's hey, thrilled
you
to be better here.
Be funny. No, yeah, right.
It's just all ad-libs.
You're all ad-libs.
And those voices you were doing at 3 years old paid off.
That's a good voice.
I sound like went heaven to me, but I guess that to some of the content providers weren't so thrilled.
So this is the first time ever, and we had to use the Silicon Graphics because it's animated in real time.
Really how the web is supported.
Right. Oh, basically, yeah. You're undermining the entire infrastructure of the web, sure.
Okay.
But at least you don't have to see
just wanted to clarify that point. Thank you. Okay.
All right.
Can
she
I get
was
some
just
email?
Beginning her career.
Oh,
this is long before
this
she
is from
out.
Dave
this,
O'Brien.
The whole idea of the show was to groom her so that she'd
say,
be good
Deb,
enough to be a network
you.
Anchor.
I love the new upgrade.
Well,
I can hardly wait to see what
it
color, pattern, coat
I don't know what
you will
happened.
Wear
there
every
is.
Night
see
now.
That?
Is he kidding
well,
me?
That's Karsten.
That's all Karsten.
See how my hair moves? I can't do that.
One unrelated question.
I said, go for it. But do read the magazines and keep your eye peeled. Listen to me. And if there are compatibility problems, we'll let you know.
You can't end the segment and say, listen to me.
Listen to me.
18 months, and Princess Diana got in a plane, car crash. And MSNBC went full-time Princess Diana coverage. That was in, I believe, 96. That's why I think it started in 95.
Yeah,
and we pitched them in 94.
That's about right.
Is that right?
Yeah. Because I was in college.
We started in 96? So I pitched them in 95. We started in 96, and she died in 97. And the ratings went through the roof.
For Diana.
And MSNBC said, you know what?
Yeah.
Why are we doing this tech crap with that weird barista when we could be a news channel? So we never came back. We went on hiatus for a couple of weeks and never came back. That was it.
But killing something led to something else.
The funny thing is that Ziff Davis, and I think this is part of the reason they killed it, had some months before started examining doing its own network. So kind of in competition, right? ZDTV, and I remember Candy approaching me.
Candy Myers.
And even then, I never got the feeling they really liked me very much. So Candy came to me, and I thought, of course, this is where I'm not self-deprecating, that they're nuts if they don't have me build this network for them. I know all about this. I know more than Candy Myers. You know, she came from TV. This is TV people running this. They need tech people running this.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, would you like to be involved in ZDTV? I said, yes. But they were constantly kind of, we don't know how much we're going to let you do kind of thing. There's always been this opinion that I shouldn't really be on TV. Wrap it up. Thank you. Lisa's going wrap it up. We haven't done the bespoke. She wants to go to dinner. Probably.
Well, we are
when's
getting
our reservation.
Eventually, we do have to go.
We
dinner.
Do have to wrap it up eventually, and we are getting into the part where people start to know the
they
story
know
a
this
little
story.
Better.
The biggest thing that happened at Tech TV was Greg Drebin, who was the program director at the time, was creating the shows, and we did a lot of brainstorming, came up with a lot of different show
By
ideas.
By the way, Revolution is now on television.
Yeah,
bumper
and,
sticker.
And this is why it didn't die. Yeah.
From the.
That was the first bumper sticker.
Yeah.
He had Internet Tonight. He had the Money Machine. He had
the Money Machine.
Remember that with Carmine Gallo?
Yeah.
Computer Shopper.
Computer Shopper was still around. Internet Tonight with Scott Harriet and Michaela Pereira, who's now on CNN, after being at KTLA for years, 14 years or something. Who else? What other shows did they already? They had shows, but they
Page View never made it, but that was one of their
they
one
did
of the pitched ones.
Right here and do part two after dinner.
No. Well, I'm going to wrap this up.
Okay.
They're saying, do you want a break now and do part two after
dinner? After dinner?
Like, I'm going to go back to college after
my radio
career.
We should do a part two eventually.
Yeah. No. So I'm just going to finish this now. This is it. This is the last story. They don't have enough shows. They don't have enough shows. They only have maybe 4 hours of shows. So they said, and I was doing radio, right? I'm doing talk radio. I'm doing 8 hours a week of talk radio. So Drebin says, how many hours could you fill? So I can fill as many hours as you want. How many hours do you want?
So you've continued to do the radio through this whole thing,
I didn't stop doing radio till Tech TV went on the air, and then I took off from 98 to 2004, then went back to radio. But I was doing radio.
Still doing the 3 day a week type thing?
No, by this time I was doing Dvorak on computers, call-in, and then eventually John left. Gina did the show for a little while. I went to KSFO, KGO. Mm-hmm. So I'm doing it by myself. Same thing I do now with the tech guy. It was exactly the same. And we even had the chat room. And Dan, Robert Scoble was the moderator of the chat room. That's how I met Scoble. He was just some guy. And then Drebin says, well, how many hours can you do? And I said, well, how many do you want? He said, could you do 2 hours? I said, Greg, I could do 8 hours. I'm doing 8 hours. I could do whatever you want. And we'll just take calls. It's cheap. And they decided to do 2 one-hour call-in shows on an interim basis because it would fill time. It was very cheap to do until they could come up with more shows. But they never thought this would. This is filler. It's cheap filler. We'll put Leo on the camera. He'll answer calls. It's complete filler. But what they didn't, and I remember Kate Patella was the IT woman who was going around, and I said, she's funny. She sings, she dances. She was in Beach Black at Babylon. You should try her out. We did a pilot for the screensavers, and they thought this is a throwaway. We're not going to put much time into this. These other shows are in fact, everybody thought Internet Tonight. It's written, it's produced, it's beautiful. We've got a comic, Scott Harriet.
It's the formula.
This is the formula. This is TV at its finest. This is going to be a hit. And what happens? Screensavers is massive out of the box, much bigger, 10 times bigger than anything else they're doing. Call for Help, even, is massive out of the box. Between the two of them...
You remember that guy?
Yeah. They ended up taking that hour, 2 hours a day, and rerunning it 3 or 4 times. I was 8 hours out of the 24 hours on Tech TV.
And when we got Nielsen ratings eventually, under the Tech TV days, Screensavers consistently the top-rated show.
Easily.
All the way to the end.
It was never a question. So I think that did not, they surprised the hell out of them. It didn't surprise me in the least because I knew exactly, and this is the same thing we've always done. People want to get information. They want how to. They don't want produced, scripted, written stuff. And so it kind of validated my feelings. And that's the end of that
story.
And
the thing I noticed when I came there in 99 was the people who worked on the show were passionate about the topic.
We loved tech.
And it makes a big difference.
And that was, and I was managing editor of Tech TV for a while. And one of the things I said, you hire people for their tech background. That's why I asked you, what was your first computer? You don't hire people because they can write. You could teach them to write. You could teach them to do TV. You hire people because they love tech. You were an exception, Sarah. But producers.
But I did love tech, and I was already working in it.
But people who were.
You actually knew TV.
You knew TV. It was the exception.
And you liked it.
We needed some accomplished TV people. So we did hire some of those. And we're very lucky. We hired some very young, but.
Well, you know, in the Tech TV days, even though, as you mentioned, it was all about being authentic and having people who knew what they were talking
exactly.
about and not doing just sort of the same old. Blah, 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 packaged TV stuff. We still were constrained by cable television. We had to take our commercial breaks at a certain time. Mm-hmm. I mean, you had to have people working as producers who could
certain
do that
and
weren't complete
cover.
Morons. Yeah. Some of them were.
To their
but
credit,
not
they
everybody.
Gave us a lot of freedom when we were going to show how to crack the Xbox. They,
I remember that.
There was a lot of, we had lots of meetings and there was a lot of risk and they said, no, do it. They gave us for the most part, complete editorial control, which was a smart thing on their part.
Yeah.
So anyway, if you have any questions?
Well,
you asked one question and I gave you a 4-hour answer.
Demonstrably smart guy, Leo Laporte, I think.
Thank you.
Been paying attention at all, and obviously talented.
I love talking about that stuff, actually. Well, I'm surprised.
I think what's great about what we've heard is you can see the roots of TWiT in all the things that you're talking about.
And I'll
give
you an example. I got so pissed off that we could do 6-minute segments and it had to start on time and end on time. What do? I'm a rebel. I show up when I want to. We go as long as we want. Somebody tells me rap, what do I say? Screw you. And that all comes from that.
It all comes from the years of having to be.
No, I'm not going to do that.
And the nice thing is that you don't have to. It's worked out really well so far.
There would be certain advantages to being starting on time and...
I like it.
Tom, those are different styles. Actually had to move TNT to a different time because you can never start on time.
Let's just not be mad every day.
But it works
let's
out.
Let's just be first.
Can I end with what I think our next step is?
Yeah, I would love to know since we work here.
First of all, more of you guys. I think one of the things that we really have to do is we have to build a team of really great people. You two are exemplars of what I need more of. And what I really think the future for us, and this is going to be a bit of a challenge. I've always said this, but I think it's really starting to happen. I look at how people consume content, and downloading something and listening to it later is, I think, going to be less and less the preferred way of doing it. So what I would like to see us do is make this more of a real time. I want to focus on the live and make it more real time. For instance, I think we need a newscast, a short little news brief at the top of every hour. I want people to dip into this and feel like they're getting a complete experience at 24/7. So that's obviously we wouldn't have built this studio if we didn't think that that was important, because that's what this is built around, is doing live production. But more and more I look at how people are consuming, and it's certainly, it's not to look at the chat room and ask, they're all doing it already, so they're the bad people, but how much of our audience is going to move in that direction? And when you have a phone or you have a device or this new Chromecast or whatever, where you just can press a button and join something in progress, I think that's a big opportunity for us to create something that's constantly interesting around a certain topic that people can be a part of. And it's going to require, you know, more hosts, more people on site all the time, making this stuff all the time. But I think that there's a big future in that.
Well, the thing I learned from you, particularly at the Screensavers, is give people what they want and let them consume it where they want, when they want it.
Right.
So, and what you're talking about is
absolutely
serve it up in all the different ways.
Absolutely.
It's not you kill it.
We'll never stop doing
that. Yeah. You have it there, but make sure that they can always jump in and join in and find something fun.
I think in the long run, what happens is you get overwhelmed by all this stuff that you've got. It's like work. I got a stack of stuff I got to listen to. It's much easier and that's what happened with Google Reader versus Twitter, right? So I think the same thing is going to happen to us, that we're kind of Google Reader-ish. We gotta get out of the inbox mentality and say, you gotta listen to this podcast, and be more. It's just always here. It's always.
It's like the radio model all over again.
It is like a live.
Just tune in.
It's kind of like KCBS.
Because they know what you want.
10-10 wins in New York said, the way they say, give us 10 minutes, we'll give you the world. That was the idea. We know you gotta commute, you're gonna go home, you're gonna push. But when you listen for that period of time, I think it was 20 minutes, you will know everything that's happened. And I think more and more we gotta move in that direction.
Radio.
Doesn't mean we don't do shows, but we've got to incorporate like updates and stuff like that, I think.
Radio model in a house of people working on a website.
Oh, I have one idea that
guy
I just
keep
doing.
Guy who knows technology getting to talk about it.
I never stop
the
doing
themes
this.
Are all in there.
You know, I had this dream that we'd see like Sarah, Kevin Rose, Patrick Norton working on their thing. And one of the things was, you could say, what music is Sarah listening to right now? And you'd have a Pandora-like stream of the music Sarah likes. What's Kevin listening to? And you'd start to develop a fandom for one of these people. Like, I'm on Kevin's team.
Oh, yeah.
I'm on the Sarah team. I'm on the Patrick team.
Yeah.
And that you'd listen to their music. You'd say, well, what is she doing? And you'd watch her camera. I still want to do that. I don't know if we'll ever get to that.
Now it's all Facebook apps. You can see what I'm listening to.
Yeah.
Updated in real time. Yeah. But it's not the same.
You can watch my Slingbox.
I think what people are looking, that's disconnected. I think people are looking for connection. I think that's why people like what we do, because you can tune in and see real people talking to you.
Yeah.
And I think that's what we have to do more of. Ultimately, that's all we do, right? It's just we talk about stuff we're interested in with you in real time.
Do you see, our focus is obviously, it's tech. It's pretty easy to figure that out. But do you see TWiT going into other verticals? I know TWiT in the past has kind of tried stuff that's a little offball,
yeah,
and it never really works.
Why isn't anybody doing a sports for TWiT?
They should.
For TWiT. Nobody's doing
it. They will.
Yeah.
Sometime.
What's taking them so long?
I don't know. There's a natural resistance to this. We on the ground see that everything is in our favor. I talked to somebody at a big company. He does social media for a big company. Won't say the name. And we were talking about their response rate on their network advertising, And the response rate from social media efforts, it's like 35 times greater from the social media efforts. So, but they spend a tiny amount of their budget. But what's going to happen is all of these companies are going to start saying, you know what, the money we're spending, the billions we're spending on television are not producing anywhere near the results as the millions we're spending on social media and new media and this kind of thing. And we got to start paying attention to this side. And mm-hmm. I think billions, in the next 5 years, billions of dollars are going to flow over. The problem is ESPN doesn't know how to do this. Nobody knows how to do this. I've had people approach me trying to, you know, well, we want to do this. The tech is the obvious because everybody who's into tech can watch. But you look at Chromecast, that for $35, that's going to make it possible for an ESPN channel.
Would you ever want to be that platform, like the TWiT umbrella? Or do you want to just keep doing TWiT?
If I were ambitious and wanted to make an empire, yeah, that's how you make $1 billion. I just wanted to make a nice little TWiT.
Well, yeah, but you say you need more talent. The people that you hire might have, you know, interests.
I think that will happen.
And
I think people,
you know, then it becomes, do you like that personality?
Yeah.
Then you're going to watch Sarah's show about rap music.
Never. Or more likely, Sarah will at some point just say, I'm done, or ESPN will call you and say, Sarah, help us do this. And so this is what will happen. Look at
ESPN.
Where's Erica Hill? You know, where is Mikhail Pereira? Where are all these people? That's what happens, is these companies call and say, well, how do you do this? You work in there. What do you do? And so you guys will get jobs somewhere else. It's another reason why I need more, because that's...
Wait, whoa.
He's firing us. Did you hear that?
No, I'm giving you permission.
This is his way of...
No.
You'll get something better.
I'm giving you permission.
We're looking for a younger...
No, I don't want to lose you guys ever.
That's like when they made a Dev Null. It's the same.
I don't want to lose you guys ever.
Okay, writing's on the wall.
I'm not saying that. I'm just saying you have permission. If some big shot calls you and offers you a big check, to show them how to do it. Look what happened to Colleen. Colleen's a very good example. Colleen said to me from day one, if I get a job offer at Google, I'm going. And I said, okay. She did. When she joined us, well, you're going to see in a little bit, I talked to Colleen in our tour of the cottage. She was a sociology major. She didn't know anything about this stuff. By the time she left, walked out the door, she is hot in-demand engineer who knows more about streaming media than most. There's five people in the country who know more than she does. Not because of me, but because in this environment, her brains, her ambition, she learned all that stuff and is in hot demand. And I think that will probably happen to other people around here. I expect that.
You don't want to own that platform, though.
I don't have the energy. I kind of like doing what we're doing. I would really, if I could just keep doing this till I die.
That's how I feel about TNT. It's fun.
That's,
deal.
Yeah.
Deal and deal.
I'm like, I don't want to
That's
move.
Basically who we're going to have here is a bunch of people who just say, I'm tired.
Yeah. I just want to do my tech news show.
I just
want
to do my job. And
I
have
don't want
my
it
little
to be any more successful than
I
it has
want to
be.
Have 100
Although,
cats.
Although, if you need somebody to have an office on the MGM lot, just let me know, because that sounds like a sweet. That sounded like a sweet gig.
I had a thing. We'd go in. It was Gina Smith and me. We'd go in. We'd sit in this empty office. Come.
Was that in Culver City? Because that's the Sony lot now,
right?
Yeah,
it was very nice.
I'd eat near there sometimes.
Yeah. It was nothing. There was nothing. We just sit there and go, okay, time to fly home.
At least you're close to LAX.
I hope I'm not revealing a bad corporate secret by saying that. It was many years
ago. I've heard many similar stories.
MGM is gone.
Yeah.
So it's okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Tom, for flying up
hey,
here. Thank you, Sarah
for
Lane,
this was
for
really
being
fun.
Here.
This was great. You know, I feel like I know your life story, but I didn't know some of the details that I learned today.
I was
so
a little worried.
I felt like it was very educational.
Good.
Yeah.
She's being very nice. You must want to
no,
keep
it was.
Job.
I didn't say I, you know.
I it liked was, it. You
it
didn't
was
say
the
you
best lecture
it.
I ever had.
I thought this was really interesting. I thought it was
I love
fun.
You guys. Yeah, I really love working with you. And I think the thing that is great is that we have that continuity with Tech TV and that we have been able to build something here that I'm pretty darn proud of. Thank you for doing it. Thank you for joining us. We couldn't do it without you at home and all of you in the studio. We'll see you next time on Triangulation.